just want to thank everybody for coming here today. And please don't forget to get your attendance verification at the end of the presentation. I know it's lunchtime, so we'll try to make this quick. Try to give you an idea about what Morocco has been going through in the past 50 years, and also open the space to questions from you guys to learn more about things that we might not be able to cover during the presentation. Just a quick, we talk about tradition and modernity, and we know from experience about countries, especially in the East, that in the past century try to move to the modern side, but at the same time hold on to the traditional history. As far as, for example, Japan or Korea, and we also have examples from the East. Also, in the case of Saudi Arabia, a country that hold on to its tradition and try to move on to the modern era. So, in Morocco, I want to show a quick presentation about the steps that Morocco have been trying to take to move to the modern world, but at the same time try to play carefully with its traditions and hold on to it as much as possible. But just a quick introduction about Morocco for the people who are not familiar about the country. Morocco is located in North Africa, as you can see from the map, and on the Mediterranean Sea and on the Atlantic Sea as well, and it's bordered by Algeria and West Sahara from the south and east. The ethnic groups that constitute Moroccans are Arab Berbers, about 90%, 54% Arabs, and the rest is Berbers, and also 1% of other ethnicities. The population since 2014, it's about 32 million inhabitants, and the language that are spoken, we have different languages. Arabic, basically the official language, and Berber languages. We have three language dialects that are also in the new constitution are official languages. We also have French, the French language, which is also the language mainly of business, government, and diplomacy. The religion of the country is 99 percent Muslims, and 1% that include Christians, Jews, and Baha'is. About 6,000 Moroccan Jews that still live in Morocco. The government type, it's a constitutional monarchy. So the king has a lot of power, and Morocco got its independence in 1956 from France. It was also occupied by Spain. The economy mostly is based on agriculture, mainly barley, wheat, and citrus fruits, grapes, vegetables, olives also, and wine. And industries, especially phosphate and also food processing goods. A quick history about the country. When we talk about tradition, there's a lot of history behind that. And since prehistoric time, it was known that the area that constitute today's Morocco has been occupied by people since end of 19 BC, and it's during the classical period it was considered a Phoenician colony, and during the 1st to the 5th century it was part of the Roman Empire as well, and after that during the 6th century it was part of the Byzantine Empire. After that, during the 7th century, it was what we know today as the Kingdom of Morocco, and it became an Islamic country with the many Islamic dynasties that ruled Morocco, starting from the 7th to the 11th century. You have the Idrisid dynasty, and then the Almoravid dynasty, Almohad dynasty after that, and between the 13th and 15th centuries, you have the Marinid, and also you have the Wattasid dynasties. Most of, if not all of these dynasties are Arab, are Berber dynasties, and then after that you have the Saidi dynasty, and the present, you know, dynasty that ruled Morocco is the Alawite dynasties, and that's an Arab dynasty. Also, it's also worth noting that Morocco has been occupied between 1912 and 1956 by the French and the Spaniard. In modern Morocco, King Mohammed V, who ruled Morocco during the French occupation, and also shortly after the end of the occupation, has been considered as a traditionalist. He basically studied in the royal school in Morocco, and most of his studies was with languages, Islamic studies, and other, for example, history, math, science, but mostly his studies was traditional studies. So during his rule, Morocco was very, very a traditional country, and at the end of his rule, probably about a year before he died, he tried to modernize the country by pointing some of the Moroccan young students who graduated from French schools during the occupation. He tried to appoint those graduates into key position in the government, trying to modernize the country. Unfortunately, he passed away, and after him came King Hassan II, who ruled the country basically until 1999. King Hassan II was a very enigmatic person, but he was also somebody who graduated with a bachelor degree in laws from University of Bordeaux. So he, in a case, was westernized, but at the same time he did all his studies before college at the Royal School. So he was also traditionalist in that sense of the word. He tried to modernize the country, but his actions were very, very small. Mostly, he created a lot of hospitals, also built a lot of universities and schools in the country. But the most important thing that he did to modernize the country is to build a lot of dams, around the country, and focused on agriculture as the main basic for Morocco's income. After his death, his son, King Mohammed VI, took power in 1999. King Mohammed VI also, did all his studies in the royal school in Rabat, but after he graduated from high school, he went also to France and did his PhD in law from the University of Nice. Unlike his father, he is more of a modern king than his father, of course, than his grandfather. He did really, really, one of his first steps that he did that was very, shocking to Moroccans is in 1999, just after he became king in 2002, he got married to a commoner, an engineer. His wife, who is a princess now, her name is Selma, was just a commoner, who was an engineer, and he, fell in love and married her. Before that, in Morocco, nobody knew the princess, the wives of the kings. They were not shown on TV, nobody knew their names, and they always were from, the same royal family. So this was a very, very big step that you know the king did to you know show that you know he's trying to modernize not just the country but also modernize the royal institution. Another step that you know, and even after that, you know, and since the time they got married, you know, you can see you know from pictures you know that Moroccans have on you know on TV or on their magazines or newspapers, the king trying to you know show that he's a modern king and just like every other Moroccan you know showing his love for his family. And also at the same time in the picture you see there are you know pictures where he's you know dressed in traditional clothes, like for example this one and this one, but there are also pictures where you know he's dressed up in you know what we call Western clothes. So there's always that you know that play between you know traditional you know outfits and modern outfits, and also the play between traditional image and you know a modern image. You know, is the king traditional? Is he modern? Is he more modern than traditional? Is he more traditional than modern? That's something that you know the king has always been trying to play, but you know it looks from the steps that he you know been taken since he became king that he's trying to show that he is more modern than traditional. In 2004 he took a big step also trying to modernize the country, and the family code basically is a code that you know basically focus on family law, you know, laws that has to do with marriage, with divorce, with you know, kids, with everything that has to do with family. We had in Morocco have had a family code since you know, even before independence, but it was really really traditional code, Islamic code that was based on interpretation of Islamic scholars that lived in the 11th century. So it was really, really traditional and old. And I think, you know, some of Arab and Muslim countries still have codes that, you know, date back to the 11th century. And I think the Moroccan king, you know, at that time figured out that, you know, it is time to change this family code, to modernize it. So he, you know, put a referendum there to, you know, modernize this family code, and Moroccan voted on it, of course, by a big, big majority. The most changes that were, or provisions that were in this family code, these are just some of them, but as you can see, for example, the new provision was both spouses share responsibilities for the family. Women are man's sister before law. That was not the case before that. You know, basically men have, you know, more responsibility after that. Once a woman comes of age, she does not need a marital tutor, a more, you know, male relative, usually the father who speaks of her behalf. Women cannot be married against their will, though if they wish to designate a male relative to act as their marital tutor, they may. And that was not the case before, you know. It only took, you know, the father to say, okay, you can marry, you know, my daughter for that, you know, young girl to be married. So that really, you know, makes a big difference, you know, in women's rights in Morocco. The minimum age for men and women to be married now is 18. That was not the case, you know, before. You know, you can see women, you know, girls, little girls, you know, getting married while they're 15, maybe even younger. A man may only take a second wife, as you probably most of you know, like in Islam or most Muslim countries, you know, men are allowed to marry four wives. This new provision came to say, you know, you can marry four wives, but there should be some rules. So men may only take a second wife if a judge authorizes it, and only if there is an exceptional and an objective justification for it. The first wife consents, of course, and the man has sufficient resources to support the two families and guarantee all maintenance rights, accommodation, and equality in all aspects of life. Moreover, a woman can stipulate in her marriage contract that her husband might not take a second wife, and a first wife must consent to the second. The first wife might also petition for divorce if the husband takes another wife. These provisions didn't exist before. A man can just, you know, decide he wants to marry a second one, and he was free to do so with no provision whatsoever. One of the provisions is that the right to a petition for divorce belongs to both men and women. Before, it was only the man who, you know, has the right to divorce. The procedures for reconciliation and mediations are encouraged. A man may not repudiate his wife without the permission of a judge, and she and her children must accord their full rights under the law. Divorce proceedings take place in a secular court rather than before a religious official. So most of divorce cases before this were done in religious officials, in front of a religious scholar. But after this provision, every marriage or divorce has to be done in front of a secular court. If a man does not fulfill his obligation according to the marriage contract or cause his wife harm, such as abandonment or violence, she has the right to file for divorce. The new law also provides for divorce in situation of mutual consent. Children's rights are protected according to the international conventions Morocco has signed. Priority in terms of child custody goes the first to the mother, then the father, then the maternal grandmother, or to whomever a judge deems the most qualified relative. Children in custody must be given suitable accommodations, the terms of which must be settled within a month of any dispute. The parents who gain custody of the child keeps the house. Before, basically, was the man who keeps the children, because he had the authority to do so. But this one changed everything for the rights of the children and rights of women. Children born outside the wedlock have the rights to the acknowledgement of paternity. That was not the case before. And a married couple may negotiate an agreement separate from the marriage contracts regarding the management of assets they acquire while married. It doesn't negate the principle of separate marital property. This, family code was really a first in the Arab and the Muslim world, and it's still a first in the Arab and Muslim world, including, for example, Tunisia, which has that country that has a family code similar, if not a little bit better than the Moroccan one. There's still a lot, needs a lot to be done in this family code. A lot of, especially women's rights organization asking for the abolition of marriage from a second or a third or a fourth wife. But I think at this time, I think the king is smart enough not to go for something like that with what's going on in the Arab world and Islamic extremism. I think it will be he wants to to die or kill himself if he does that. That will definitely be against his dynasty and his ruling. So this was very applauded. It was very applauded by a human rights organization, by the European Union, and also by the United States as a big step toward women's rights, especially in Morocco. Another step that were taken, it was during the Arab Spring. As most of you know, that in 2011, most of the countries in the Arab world were going through what we call today the Arab Spring or a revolution. And Morocco, also got its share of protests, not revolution. People during that time, went to the street and started protesting not against the monarchy, but against better rights and less, less power for the king. And I think the king was smart enough and modern enough to propose some constitutional changes to modernize the country. And he also put a referendum in front of the people, and the majority, more than 90%, voted yes for that referendum, which has some constitutional changes like the one that you have here. For example, the prime minister would be named from the largest party elected to parliament. That was not the case before. The king was the one who appointed the prime minister. The prime minister would be able to appoint government officials and minister. Also was not the case. The king basically appointed all government officials. The prime minister would have the power to dissolve parliament. Before, the king had that right, and the judiciary would be an independent branch, and that was not the case. This really, calmed down the most of the Moroccan society, and basically was a first step, you know, toward not having, you know, a monarchy like, for example, in Britain or in other, you know, European country, but it's a first step toward having a democratic country. A lot of, you know, some of the Moroccans still not happy about the changes. They want more, but this is, you know, the steps that were done by the king to move toward that modernization. There were a lot of also, you know, decrees that, you know, this we're talking about the political side, you know, of the modernization that have been done, you know, have been, you know, done in Morocco in the past decade. For example, the anti-corruption decree, the right to work and the right to health, and also a specialized road behavior code. If you've been to Morocco, you will definitely know that, you know, driving there is a crazy thing, and it took a lot of work to come out with a specialized road behavior code. A lot of Moroccans still not happy about it, you know, but it was a really good step toward modernize the country and put a rule there that will, you know, modernize the behavioral code that Moroccans didn't have before. On the economical side, you know, in the past 10 years, you know, the government of Morocco took a lot of steps to modernize the country, and one of them was building the largest port in Africa in the city of Tangier, and also building a free trade zone that, you know, help Morocco to compete with African countries, but also compete with the European countries on the Mediterranean. Also, there's a big work in renewable energy, and Morocco is spending a lot of money and bringing a lot of investments from especially Gulf regions and Europe and also the US, and investing in renewable energy with the date in mind in 2020 to have Morocco's half of energy produced by renewable energy. So this is something important that the government has been working on for some years, and the date is to have 2020 Morocco half of its energy produced by renewable energy. Also, Morocco signed a free trade agreement with the US. I think one of the, or the only Arabic country that has that free trade agreement with the US, and only also signed an advanced status agreement with the European Union, which gave a big chance to, you know, compete and also modernize its economy. When it comes to infrastructure, for the past 10 years, you know, Morocco has been investing in infrastructure, and Morocco has, I think, about 47 airports. Only 11 of them are modern, but they're now, I think, spending and investing a lot of money in modernizing the other one. They have more than 60 ports. The biggest one is in Tangier, of course, one of the most one of the biggest ones also in Casablanca. The rail system also is very, very advanced compared to African countries, and building trams in bigger cities to help with transportation. So the government have been, you know, spending a lot of money investing in infrastructure to, you know, get the country compete with the, you know, not just African countries, but European countries in the 21st century. We talked a little bit about, you know, modernization as in the politics and economy, but, you know, when it comes to the tradition, you see it, you know, on a daily basis everywhere you go in Morocco, especially with, for example, the outfits. Like, for example, Moroccans are very, very, keen in still wearing, you know, their traditional outfits. For example, here you see the kaftan, which is the traditional outfit of female Moroccans, and here, for example, the jellaba, which is the traditional
outfit of Moroccan males. And this, you know, clothing you see it not only, you know, in holidays, for example, but you see people wearing it on a daily basis, either in government offices or, you know, institutions. So anywhere you go, you see people still holding to that tradition. You also see it, you know, in, for example, architecture or, you know, interior design. You know, like you see buildings that are very modern, but once you go inside, Moroccans really, really make sure to decorate their homes according to the Moroccan traditional, you know, decor, you know, especially the mosaics and, you know, and also, you know, the traditional, like, for example, tables, as you see them, they're all traditional. And also, you see in food, you know, people very, very keen into preserving their, you know, gastronomy, their traditional gastronomy, and with all the, you know, international, you know, restaurants, chain restaurants that exist nowadays in Morocco, Moroccans still hold on to their traditional food and still eat it on a daily basis. For example, like couscous, one of the main, you know, dishes in Morocco. That's something that Moroccan basically eats every Friday. So at least that's the Friday dish. So people after the, you know, they go to the mosque for the Friday prayer and come back, that's their traditional dish to have. Of course, there are other traditional dishes, like for example, tagine, that most Moroccans eat on a daily basis. One of the things that you see also, tradition plays a big role is in weddings, you know. Weddings are still done in a traditional way, either when we talk about, you know, rich families or middle class or, you know, low class family, they still hold on to their tradition, and especially in weddings, you know, brides and grooms are still, they still wear traditional outfits, you know, as you can see here, these are traditional activities that are done, you know, during the ceremony, traditional music, traditional food, traditional interior design, so everything is done in a traditional way. Also, the, you know, you see the tradition being important in when it comes to music. So even if music nowadays, with the world being a global village, you see, you know, people listening to different music from all over the world, but Moroccans still hold on to their traditional music, and there are many, many kinds of traditional music in Morocco. And nowadays, you know, Morocco is trying to give, you know, more opportunity to those, you know, kind of music by, you know, doing a lot of concert to different, you know, kind of music. At the same time, trying to be open to the modern world, and I think Morocco nowadays have a concert, probably one of the biggest in Africa, that, you know, invites singers from all over the world to come and sing, and it's a free festival for that lasts for 7 days. A lot of singers from all over the world come there, you know, to sing. This also brings me to the, you know, the question of modernity and tradition. You know, a lot of Salafis, a lot of Muslim Salafis in Morocco were not happy about that festival in the beginning, you know, and they're still not happy about it because they see modernity as something inferior. They see it as something against their tradition. So they always protest against that, you know, festival, and trying to make sure that give priority to Moroccan music rather than opening, you know, our country to, you know, Western music. So there is still that debate, you know, happening nowadays in Morocco between tradition and between modernity, but it looks like modernity is winning because it comes from the top. You know, the monarchy is trying to modernize the country, and the monarchy has been ruling, you know, the country for a long time, and I think Morocco will definitely take more steps to modernize its economy, to modernize its institution, and to modernize, you know, its customs and way of life. there definitely be still people who are not happy about that modernity, but I think in the meantime, Morocco was successful into moving step by step, carefully, step by step toward a modern world without creating problems with the people who are traditional. So thank you very much for your time. And if you have any questions concerning what we talked about or what I didn't talk about, please feel free to ask. We have about 10 to 15 minutes, you know, so please feel free. So thank you.